through experiments and observations is science. An institute that fosters this passion and aptitude towards science. National Science Center, Delhi. From a temporary site office to allotment of land in Pragati Maidan, from setting up to its inauguration, and from then to today, this pioneer institute has come a long way. This architectural marvel, located in the heart of the city and in close proximity to the old fort, is a striking example of harmony between a glorious past and a radiant future. Today, National Science Center, the northern headquarter of National Council of Science Museums, along with its satellite units, has created a formidable presence across northern India.
National Council of Science Museums was set up in 1978 with the primary objective of inculcating scientific temper among the population of India and with a special emphasis on young children. So it was the need to proliferate the message of science among the common population all over the country. It was necessary to start an institution that will provide informal science education. And this is an opportunity for everyone to activate their inquisitive mind.
Over the period of time, National Science Center has created its own style of presentation. And here, even history-based exhibits are interactive in nature. It houses several permanent exhibition halls on different theories of science, right from prehistoric era to the emerging technologies of future. These galleries take you to a whole new world of admiration and amazement. By keeping it simple and making it fun, it promotes family edutainment. Special shows like 3D theatre, Science on Sphere, Inflatable Planetarium, and most popular amongst all, Spark Theatre, where live experimental demonstrations are conducted on daily basis to engage, educate and entertain the students. To enhance their scientific temper, students can get enrolled in various advanced tech labs at NSC and get a hands-on experience as well. It has world-class in-house workshops with a team of experts continuously working on new ideas, so that the next time you visit the center, you have something new to explore. To benefit students, NSE Delhi organizes orientation activities such as seminars, lectures, innovation fairs, science camps, exhibitions, and other programs in urban as well as rural areas. Eminent personalities from across the world visit the center to interact with young, impressionable minds. If you are a science enthusiast and cannot reach National Science Center, then the center will reach you. To reach the unreached, NSC's fleet of advanced mobile exhibition vans make sure that science is no longer confined to only laboratories or research institutes of big cities. Various outreach programs and events in form of science festivals are also modes to reach the schools and different education bodies. Through exceptionally brilliant educational programs, outstanding galleries, engaging activities and workshops, NSE has increased its visitors' footfall from near 2 lakh in 90s to more than 7 lakh on-site visitors every year now. It has ignited numerous minds and inspired many to choose scientific careers in their lives.
National Science Centre, Delhi is a non-formal educational institute engaged in creation of a society that has scientific bent of mind. This is an institution that believes in wholesome family edutainment and engaged in igniting the young minds.
NSE is on the path of creating a generation that is enlightened of its scientific and technological history and capable to take on the future. And its guiding principles are: excite, engage, educate, and empower. National Science Centre, Delhi. Curiosity leads to questions.
Good afternoon, sir. Okay. So, on behalf of the National Science Center, I'm Kailash Chandra, welcoming you all to this online lecture. On the topic Underwater Archaeology in India. And the speaker of the day is Professor Alok Tripathi, who is Additional Director General, Archaeological Survey of India. Now, those who have joined the National Science Centre program for the first time, let me introduce National Science Centre to you. The National Science Centre is a unit of the National Council of Science Museums. And the National Council of Science Museums administers around 25 science centers and science cities which are spread all over India. And the basic objective of this National Council of Science Museum is to generate, develop scientific temper among everyone, especially school students. So if you are in any part of the city, I request you all to look for the nearest science center or science city and go visit this and give us the feedback. Now, today is a day which we are celebrating as International Day of Scientific Culture. Before we formally move further, let me also introduce to you Sri Ramdas Iyer, who is the director in charge of the National Science Center, and I request him to say a few words on the importance of this particular day. Sir, mic, please put on your mic on.
Thank you, Kailash ji, and thank you for giving me an opportunity to take part in this program. Now, why celebrate a day of scientific culture? To understand this, let us for a moment ask, what is science? Science started off as an alternative way of looking at the natural world and the things around us and trying to make sense of these things, these objects, these laws that govern the universe on a day-to-day basis and make sense out of it. Slowly, science became a large body of knowledge as well as a process, a method by which the world around us can be investigated in a much deeper way. Experiments can be performed and different natural laws understood and new principles discovered. So science as it stands today is one of the most powerful tools available to humanity to study the cosmos around us. And it also gives birth to technology, which is another very powerful tool, which is used by all disciplines, be it medicine, be it archaeology, be it art, be it history, whatever. Technology and its parent, science, are being used extensively these days to understand things about us and about our surroundings in a much better way. These are challenging times. We have been living through a terrible pandemic for the past almost 2 years now, which has affected the whole world, and millions have been killed because of this, and many more have been affected, and it is still ravaging humanity. Another very important challenge before us is climate change. This year itself we see very erratic climatic patterns. We see a very extended monsoon. We see all kinds of erratic weather phenomena. All this is because of undue human intervention in nature. The demand for energy keeps on rising, and when the demand for energy keeps on rising, we need to exploit our natural resources to such an extent that sustainable living becomes difficult, if not impossible. So the energy demands need to be met very innovatively. There are many, many, many challenges like this, many questions that surround us which demand answers. And science is the best way to get into the root of these questions and dig out the answers. In order to do this, the society as a whole needs to develop a culture of science. When I say a culture of science, a way in which you can use the scientific methods to attack your problems and come up with a solution. Many institutions and individuals around the world contribute to strengthening what I call the scientific culture by trying to create a public understanding of science. As I mentioned earlier, any field of human activity can benefit by using science and technology. So creating a public understanding of science among all people, among the broadest cross-section of the society, is a very important thing that we need to do. While scientists are doing science, communicators of science create a public understanding in science. And that is what we are commemorating today on the 28th of September by observing this as the Day of Scientific Culture. The institutions who founded this initiative just last year where several institutions distributed all over the world, I'm not reading out all those names, it will not be very relevant, and I'll be standing in the way of the speaker today. It was a very important topic to speak about. So this, let us remember, is a day in which we can create a culture among people around us, our friends, our families, our classmates, to use science as a tool to understand our day-to-day problems. I thank National Science Center and the organizers for giving me this opportunity to mention what the Day of Scientific Culture is. On behalf of National Science Center, I welcome today's speaker, Dr. Alok Tripathi, and I request Kailash Chandra to introduce the speaker before we go into the topic. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, and you have quite elaborated the subject and the importance of the day. I request now my colleague, Sri Bharat Bhushan Srivastava, to elaborate the topic, and then I request my colleague, Sri Rakesh Tripathi, to introduce the speaker of the day formally.
Thank you,
Mr.
About today's lecture, this is the topic is underwater archaeology in India. The developments in science and technology provided means for entering the inner space of the earth and working in great depths with ease. These developments in underwater technology were also successfully utilized by archaeologists to search, retrieve, and study sunken material evidence of human activities in the past. Scientific study of underwater cultural heritage has evolved as a specialized branch of archaeology to study these traces of human activities to reconstruct missing links of human history, particularly maritime history. The lecture today would give brief introduction to the subject and its development in the country, including information on some of the systematic underwater archaeological excavations conducted in RBN Sea and the Bay of Bengal.
Thank you, Sivasanji. Now, I'll request my colleague, Sri Rakesh Tripathi, to formally introduce the speaker, and then we'll move on to the subject.
Thank you, sir. Professor Alok Tripathi is a basically well-known archaeologist, especially in underwater excavation. Professor Alok Tripathi is a distinguished archaeologist and pioneer underwater archaeologist in India. With his long experience in field and archaeology, heritage management, higher education, and research, he is renowned authority in history, archaeology, heritage management. He has directed several archaeological excavations in different parts of country, as well as in Indian Ocean. He founded the Underwater Archaeological Wing in the Archaeological Survey of India. Several underwater archaeological excavations conducted under the direction in his direction, basically in Arabian Sea as well in Bay of Bengal. The most experienced underwater archaeologist in the country, he has worked as a resource person in UNESCO, Asia Pacific Field School for training of underwater archaeologists. He has basically trained archaeologists from several countries. He is expert in museology, art history, heritage management, art and archaeologists, and architects. Widely traveled in several countries in Europe, Africa, and Asia, he is the only social scientist listed among the 10 brightest young scientists in the country. Since 2009, he is a professor of Assam University in Silchar, the Central University. Presently, he is Additional Director General in Archaeological Survey of India, Ministry of Culture, Government of India. His focus is now on critical analysis of policies of heritage management, archaeological research, and underwater understanding of itihas. So, I formally welcome Professor Alok Tripathi in this platform to enlighten us in the topic. Basically, it's a basically very interesting topic, underwater archaeologists. Sir, please.
Unmute.
Yeah. Good evening to everyone. My previous speakers have spoken about science, technology, climate change, culture, and when we speak about underwater archaeology, it takes care of or it touches almost all these subjects. When we talk about science, it has been explained, or technology, which is needed, because when we talk about underwater, we need to use these latest technologies or underwater technology. Can you see the screen? Is it visible, the slides?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Visible, sir.
Yeah. So if you have a look of the globe from any direction, you will find that large part of the globe is covered with water. And the water area is almost 2/3 of the total area. So we are living on a very limited portion, and whereas a larger part is covered with water. But man has never been restricted to lands only, and right from the very early times he had been venturing in these water areas. Generally, some people will talk about seas as the barriers, but for many others they are the roads, and people have used them for crossing the seas and going to the distant lands. And evidence of their these various activities are also lying under the water. And with the climate change, that is one thing what we generally refers the shipwrecks. Besides that, a number of coastal settlements, because of the sea level fluctuation, have also gone underwater. And in the coastal areas, we find number of ancient ports, ancient cities, and other settlements which have got submerged, and that also become part of underwater cultural heritage. When we say underwater cultural heritage, we are talking about different kind of traces of human activities which are submerged for at least 100 years. Now, that is a timeline which has been fixed even in archaeology also, when we say the ancient remains or archaeological objects. So if any human traces in a different forms, they are submerged for 100 years, maybe for a periodical or partial or completely, then they are considered as the underwater cultural heritage. And when we have a glance about our position in Indian Ocean, we find that India is very prominently placed in Indian Ocean. And we have got a long coastline. It's a very long coastline, more than 7,500 kilometers. We have got a large number of islands, 1,197, and a huge water area. And you all are aware that our maritime history goes back very conveniently to 5,000 years, but we find even evidences starting right from the Mesolithic period. So we have got a very rich history, we have a very rich maritime history, we have got a large water area, and daring or entrepreneuring Indians who were very good navigators, boat builders. So this whole water area is very rich in underwater cultural heritage. Some of the works have been done and a number of sites have been identified. But what we know today is a very, very small part of of this area, because it's a huge area and where a great scope still exists. And most of the area is still uncharted, unexplored. So it's a mine of information about the past, about previous things and activities. And not only that, even within the country, in internal waters, we have got a number of navigable rivers, we have got lakes and reservoirs, and many other historical tanks, wells, swamps. So a large number of water bodies, and they all can be very useful for underwater archaeological studies. As I have already mentioned about our maritime history, we have evidence in various forms, maybe the paintings or the boat models or in sculpture or in literature. We get a regular information about these activities in water bodies and international trade contexts. So we have got a lot of information, and that is in form of literature or art, but we also have the material evidence which are lying submerged in these water bodies. Underwater archaeology started somewhere in the middle of the last century, but in India it started around in the 80s of last century. When we started, there was no experience. It was just experiments and discoveries, and then we learned from our own mistakes, we improved, and that is how the archaeology, underwater archaeology, or the search of archaeological remains in Indian waters started. The first attempt was made by the scientists. They were the geophysicists of Indian Ocean, Indian Institute of Ocean, National Institute of Oceanography. And then archaeologists realized its importance, and they started searching these sunken remains near these well-known archaeological sites which are mentioned in literature. So it was just a very humble beginning. A small project was started with the help of many scientific institutions and cultural institutions. And when this work began, it got a lot of publicity, because that was something unexpected. And when this all happened, there was a lot of enthusiasm, people, a lot of publicity. And of course, it was on a very small scale, but we got a lot of support from everyone, and then this branch kept developing. This is the first document when the underwater archaeologists started a project proposal. And this kind of photographs, when they came out in the media and all, generated a lot of curiosity about these submerged remains, and the subject became very popular. Slowly, then we had international collaborations, trainings abroad, and collaborative work with institutions which were having experience in this field, and then the advanced trainings of those who were interested. Though we have got such a huge water area, but the number of archaeologists who came forward or who are working still is very limited. And that was a time when even there was more awareness about the importance of underwater cultural heritage. And even in 1996, ICOMOS brought a charter on protection and management of underwater cultural heritage. So that was a developing phase when things were improving. And in the third phase, what we see from the beginning of this century was very fruitful. So that was the third decade for underwater archaeology in India. And in the beginning, the world got 2001 Convention on Protection of Underwater Cultural Heritage. This was the first legislation in a form which was drafted by experts from various countries, and UNESCO adopted it in 2001. Even it took a long time to get implemented, because people were very apprehensive about certain provisions, because water area is very important, because now everybody is realizing the importance of the seas, and everybody wanted to be very cautious initially. And that was the time when Archaeological Survey of India, after a long struggle, established underwater archaeology wing. And from there, these archaeological activities started, formalized, proper regulations were done, and the systematic large-scale excavation, you can say, started. So 2001 was a very, very important year, not only for India, but even for the whole world, when we talk about underwater cultural heritage. And first focus was definitely, when we talk about underwater archaeology, we are talking about waters, and a medium which is not very favorable, it's alien. So if you have to work underwater, you need to have a different kind of technology for everything. Even if you want to walk, I mean, want to swim or dive, you need to have the technology for that. If you want to see, then you require, if you want to take photographs, if you want to retrieve something, or you want to do anything underwater, you need help of some technology is needed. And the underwater means developments in underwater technology started right from the Second World War. That was for the military purposes, but slowly these all things were utilized in other areas also. And archaeology, that is a field of culture, they were also not behind, and they utilized these different kind of techniques and tools and different methods for the search, study, retrieval and preservation of underwater cultural heritage. Some of the major excavation or some of the systematic archaeological excavation which have been conducted in India from 2001, I'm going to tell you about them so you can have a feel that what kind of sites are there, what kind of materials we have found, and how they look like, or how you feel when you go underwater. The first excavation was conducted at Bangaram Island. That was a shipwreck of 18th century, and it was very carefully selected for various purposes. One thing more I would like to tell you, when you are working underwater, besides technology, besides other things, you also need to have the collaboration, because there are various institutions which are having expertise in different areas. And no single institution can be, be having these all things. So it's always better to share the infrastructure or expertise which are already available with different institutions. And having that in the mind, Archaeological Survey of India started collaboration with Indian Navy. Indian Navy was selected because they have got state-of-the-art objects, I mean technology, they have got all infrastructure, they have got trained divers and huge manpower, and so those all things can also be utilized for the explorations, for the preservation of cultural heritage and for constructive activities. And this collaboration went very well, and the first study was carried out of Bangaram Island. This is a Google image of a small island which is in Arabian Sea. This is hardly half a kilometer long, small uninhabited island in the Arabian Sea off the Kodla, off Kerala coast. And it has got another small one, and it has got a huge lagoon. And it's a tourist destination. People go there, there is a resort, and nobody lives on it. And it has got a beautiful, this lagoon, a shallow water, and this has got a coral reef. On the outer slope of this coral reef, a shipwreck was found. Probably this ship, which was coming from Southeast Asia and going to Europe, might have saw this island, and maybe for the water or for some other purpose, we do not know, they might have tried to reach. And this coral reef is submerged during the high tide, and its top is visible during the low tide. So it's possible that during high tide, probably the ship could not see that there is a reef. And when they advanced towards the island, they struck, the ship got struck on that and got capsized. Because we see the material spread from the uppermost terrace to going down at a different depth. And that is the reason that we had decided to work on that, because it has got several terraces starting from 9 meter going almost to 64 meter. So we started working from a shallow depth. Now again, when we are talking about underwater excavation or diving or walking underwater, then you have to see many factors work there. Whether it is the pressure which a diver feels, or the breathing apparatus which you use, or the methods which are you are using for digging or moving these objects, for their preservation, different effects of marine flora and fauna on the cultural heritage. So there are several scientific aspects are associated with almost every activity. This is one of the largest object which is lying still on the site. If you go and dive, you will see this huge anchor of the ship, which is on the edge. And it's very heavy, more than 5 meters in length. And it is well preserved still because it has got incrustation over its surface. So first we decided to have a detailed hydrographic survey, and we used the Indian naval ship INS Jamuna for this purpose. Navy has got a number of survey ships which they keep working in the Indian Ocean for hydrographic services. So we used different kind of tools, these acoustic tools, to survey those outer reefs. And after doing the survey, then we decided for underwater excavation. And for excavation, we used again an Indian naval ship, Nirdeshak. And this is a diving ship which has got all the facilities, including the decompression chamber, the different kind of gases which are required for deeper diving. They have got expert divers on that, expert medical team. In case of emergency, to transfer divers or a person to the land, helicopters, the crane and the small boats. So it was our floating base which we used, and this island itself is far away from the mainland, around 400 nautical miles. So we needed something like that, and with the help of this very advanced ship, diving ship, we could work to a very deeper area that is around 54 meters. So first we explored. Here you can see in the background, if you can see, this is the island, a small strip looking at the background. Then there is a big lagoon, and we are working on the outside. So these speed boats were used for the survey, and here on the monitor we are watching what is underwater. This yellow is a cable, and the camera goes down with the diver. And to working on an archaeological site is different than other activities of the Navy. So all the divers who are well trained, they were given a training how to work on an archaeological site, how to document every object before it is disturbed, and what all they are supposed to do, what they are not supposed to do, and they have to report everything. And it was under the very close monitoring. Every activity was monitored from the surface, and we had gazettes for that. Cameras were mounted underwater on the side, so whatever is happening on the bottom of the sea was seen, and instructions were given. We had communication systems, so all facilities were available. So it was a very advanced, very systematic, the first underwater archaeological excavation in the country, which started from 9 meters and went down up to 54 meters. And it is still one of the deepest archaeological site which have been excavated, not only in India, but this in entire Indo-Pacific region. So we used a different kind of diving gears. When you have to go down, you have to carry your own air, because you cannot breathe otherwise like fish, because we don't have gill, we have got the lungs. So we use general scuba gears, or when one has to work for a longer duration, or one has to do some specific kind of job, then we use the super light helmet, where the air is supplied from the surface, and they also carry the communication system. So the diver who is working down there can communicate with the supervisor or the archaeologist sitting on board, and can take instruction, and then accordingly he can carry out the work. This is how the surface of the coral reef looks like. So initially this whole area was surveyed. Though there are a number of artifacts which are exposed on the surface itself, but since they are lying there for centuries, they have been covered with these kind of, sometimes with coral or sometimes with other vegetational growths or calcareous deposits, and they also look like the dead corals. So one has to be very careful in their identification while doing the exploration. We were also very cautious about the environment because corals are very sensitive, and any activity or pollution may affect their growth or they even may die. So we took extra care, and we also had some experts of coral who suggested us that how we should work on the site so that there is no damage or minimum damage in case if there is any. And therefore we did this work very systematically. The entire area was explored, and as we do in archaeology, the area was divided in different grids using these different lines. You can see one of the yellow line here. So the whole area was divided for better recording and for divers to know and work in a specific area, and all these grids were given a specific numbers. And this is how the divers were going with a camera, and this is a camera which is connected with this cable to a monitor which is kept on the surface. So the person sitting on the top can see what all is here, and this is how the every activity was properly monitored and documented. In archaeology, documentation is very important because excavation is generally considered an destructive activity. Because once you disturb an antiquity from its context, you cannot put it back exactly in the same position. So it has to be recorded, because once you do the excavation, it is only the documentation which remains with you. So all these objects which were lying, they were identified, they were marked, they were numbered properly, and then their location was fixed. They were documented through various means, depending upon its importance, its location, by drawings or by photographs, and none of them were disturbed. What the 2001 UNESCO Convention emphasized on the in-situ preservation of underwater cultural heritage. And when we started underwater archaeology wing in 2001, we adopted the rules which are annexed to this convention, and we followed those well-known or accepted practices, and we also followed the principle of in-situ preservation. Therefore, all these antiquities which are lying spread in a large area on the reef were not disturbed, they were not all picked up, they were studied there itself and were left there as they were. So in future, if any archaeologist goes or even a tourist goes, he can see them in their context. So this is a piece, part of a large glazed jar. This is a Southeast Asian jar, what we call it, Martaban, having a decoration and handles, sorry, which is lying again at the bottom. So it was numbered and photographed and documented. Once the whole area was studied, it was divided in grids and numbers. Then we selected few grids for the scientific study. We knew about the wreck. We came to know about its nature, the cargo which it was carrying, and our purpose was not to lift the cargo. We wanted to study the status of preservation, the kind of deposition, and what might have, what might have happened in the past, how this cargo got distributed on these different terraces. So we started excavating few trenches. First, these dead corals were removed mechanically in certain cases, or manually wherever they were in small pieces and the loose deposits. They were deposited in a safer area so that there is no damage to the corals. And wherever there were hard incrustations or deposits, other devices were used, and we found different kind of objects, copper object, iron object, objects made of lead, different kind of pottery, different kind of glazed ware. We had a porcelain from there, glass objects, and the entire ship was covered with a copper sheet. and its fittings were also made of copper. And that includes the huge rods, which were almost 1.5 meters in length, to the nails, which were used for sheathing. They were very hardly 1 or 2 centimeter in size. So a variety of objects were found from these sites. These are some of the cannons which are found on the site. The ship was carrying a number of cannons, and 4 of these cannons were identified, and 1 of the cannon was retrieved again for testing our retrieval skills and also for scientific study to see the effects of marine water on the steel, this iron cannons. After doing this work, then these results were presented in an international seminar, and the interim report was also brought out so that the everybody knows that what work was carried out. After the first excavation in the Arabian Sea, then we had another project in the Bay of Bengal that was off Mahabalipuram. Mahabalipuram, which is in Tamil Nadu, it's a famous center of art and architecture of Pallava period. And this temple, which is known as Shore Temple, is inscribed on the UNESCO World Heritage. And this is these are general satellite images. This is how the coastline is. These are all structures and caves and all Pallava structures, art, architecture, their representations are here. And along this coast, there are few reefs which are submerged. This is a close-up of that. So there are 3 submerged ridges here. And the top of these ridges were also used for some human activities or art activities. Their tops are also visible during low tide, and they get submerged during the high tide. And there are, for last few centuries, all Europeans who passed through this area or who have visited this place have recorded certain traditions about the submergence of temples in the sea. The place was known as Seven Pagoda, and the Shore Temple is considered as the one which has been left. Remaining 6 have been submerged. We wanted to again check that whether it's a true or it's just a legend. So we carried out first exploration along the coast. When there is a low tide, one can see a number of such architectural fragments which are lying along the coast, which clearly suggests that there were many structures other than the temples which are existing on the shore, which have got destroyed by the sea, and their remains are lying there. As this in certain period of a year, when there is a very low tide, one can see even certain foundations of these structures which would have been constructed in the past. This kind of box-like structures, you find a series of them going deep in the sea. And the technology was so effective that even today, they are still in their place. And above these, there would have been the walls or other structures. So it became clear to us that there were structures, and means more structures than what is the present Shore Temple is. Then we had a plan. First, we surveyed the area, we did the hydrographic study, and then we decided to conduct underwater archaeological excavations. Since the water is not very deep there, it's a shallow, and it has got a number of rocks underwater, so it was not possible for any other big ship to come, and therefore we used an amphibious ship, which can come very close to the, or even come up to the shore in a very shallow water. And INS Ghorpad was utilized for conducting underwater archaeological excavations here. We followed that standard system, and also these small boats to conduct diving operations near this rock. Here you can see one of the rock whose top is visible during low tide. And they have got a flat surface on the top, and when you go very close to it, they are all covered with the barnacles. So it's very difficult. They are very sharp and strong. They will cut your shoes and skin and everything. So, but when you go close to them and study, you find that there are certain human activities. And when we carried out underwater excavation, also we found these step-like cuttings on various rocks, a series of walls-like structures, a variety of other stone slabs, or with the carvings, or with the holes. So definitely they were man-made. We can make it out. So that was very clear that near these rocks also there were certain activities. But what kind of structures they could have been? Now that was a big question. And for that we again surveyed the nearby area, and we found even on the shore also we have similar signature on rocks where the superstructures were constructed after having a foundation, having a platform, and then above that these structures were constructed. We also carried out excavation on shore, and there also we found remains of a number of temples, and one of them was a very large temple that was 1.5 times bigger than the shore temple, which is still existing, and that was of again of Pallava period. So that become very clear that at Mahabalipuram also there were a number of structures which have been either destroyed by the sea or which have got submerged. So that was again a very rewarding exercise which we had. And this work was carried out soon after the tsunami. So there was a lot of interest of media and public, and media around the world covered this excavation. There was no known media house which has not covered it anywhere from the any other country. Then another project which we took was at Dwarika. Dwarika is one of the most famous underwater, means not the one of the most, it is the most famous underwater archaeological site when we talk about underwater archaeology in India. This is a satellite view. The town of Dwarika on the westernmost tip. There is a small river which meets the sea, and according to the literature, the city was established where the Gomti meets the sea. So we selected this area for our study. Then this is a close-up view, and the background, there is a famous temple of Dwarikadhish. And the story says that when Krishna left Mathura, he moved to Dwarika and he established his capital city there. And after his death, the city got destroyed. And some literature says it got submerged in the sea. So that was the story. And this place has been under investigation for almost a century by historians, archaeologists, and underwater archaeologists. So, but there were different kind of claims. So we finally decided, we were asked to work there. Then we used again a hydrographic ship to carry out the underwater surveys. This is a small survey boat using a multi-beam sonar and side scan sonar. And this survey boats covered this whole area very close to the present or modern town of Dwarika. All this data was captured through various means, and wherever we found any signature or possibility of finding any artifact or objects or any structure that was properly marked, this data was analyzed and we prepared a big, very detailed hydrographic sheet. Based on that, a three-dimensional model of the bottom of the sea was prepared, and then finally the diving operations started, and we found there are a number of stone structures, rocks and other things which are fully covered with the vegetation. So from just by seeing them you cannot make out anything, one has to clear them. So the vegetation has to be cleaned, and then the thick deposition on them has to be cleared by scraping or by rubbing. And after you clean them, then their shape becomes clear. And here you can see a number of properly cut huge stone blocks which have been used for construction of the stone structures. They may be walls, they may be houses, or stones like that might have been used for the circular or semicircular structures. So all these remains which are lying there, they were again systematically documented, studied, and all the details were captured through various means. Drawings were prepared, and when we carried out excavation near these stones, we found that they were not in situ. And that was one thing, so that we could not really determine the exact nature of these structures, because the sea is, means the current and waves are very strong here, and they might have moved this structure from their original position, or they might be even moving, because unless we monitor them for a long time, we cannot make out that where exactly they were and what kind of, what shapes they really made. After working in these important sites, we also worked in one of the internal in internal waters. This is important because generally most of the people feels when we talk about underwater archaeology, we are talking about the sea. That's not the case. Underwater archaeology can be done anywhere in the country. And this is again a satellite photograph of northeastern region. And here you see this spot, this is a lake, a very famous lake, Loktak Lake in the state of Manipur in northeastern region. And this is a huge lake, earlier even it was larger, it's slowly sinking now. And there are a number of these islands. People still live here, and during, in a distant past, what you call the Neolithic also, people were living around and in this lake. And therefore, we thought that this lake might be having some early deposits of early settlers of northeastern India. And with that objectives, we carried out underwater explorations. But this lake is full of this weed, what is called fumli. And it's a very thick cover of these weeds. So we could not really work in a large area or in a very open area. But but archaeologically, this lake is extremely important as far as the study of early settlements in northeastern India is concerned. Because once the these organic materials, they if they fall down and they are covered with the sediment, they remain preserved there for ages. And otherwise, you don't find them because the climate of northeast is very humid and high rains. So all these material get deteriorated and you don't find any material evidence. But underwater excavation is a wing which can really help in finding some of the earliest material evidence in this region. This is a view of these two islands which are still inhabited, and people are living there. People also live on these floating islands. These grass islands, they keep floating and people live on that also. After that, there was a sharp decline in underwater activities in the last decades. And again, we are now trying to revive these activities, and hopefully, again, with the cooperation of all and all those who are interested, we will be able to start these activities again in a better way. It requires the training of young archaeologists and those who are interested from departments, universities, volunteers. There are a number of publications available about the work which have been done in the past, and many people, historians and archaeologists, are now working on maritime history or underwater cultural heritage. So now we have got sufficient information available about underwater cultural heritage in the country. There are other scope, means there are other branches also which have got a great scope, and young students in different universities have also been given a short-term training, and more training programs are needed. And these are some of the publications which are available on the excavations which are conducted, and these some of the preliminary, means the interim reports on the excavations. and proceedings of the conferences which we used to held, inviting experts from all over the world. So now we have sufficient information available about underwater cultural heritage. As far as expertise is concerned, we have proved that we can handle any kind of, means we can work on any kind of site to greater depths. Institutions like the Archaeological Survey of India, which is the prime, means the most, means it is the central organization responsible for cultural heritage. Number of universities having archaeology departments, departments which are related to oceans and oceanography, and other institutions which are operating in the sea or waters, they all can come together to search, study and preserve this underwater cultural heritage. 2001 convention has now been ratified by a large number of countries, and they are following the principles which are laid down in this convention. As I had mentioned earlier, that we have adopted the rules which are annexed to the convention. India had voted in the favor of convention when it was adopted in 2001. And we can also think of ratifying the convention and having the collaboration with all those countries who have ratified this convention. So it gives you chance that Indians can go and work with those countries, or the experts of those countries can come and work if we have a shared heritage. So that provides you a lot of other opportunities to work with other experts. Niti Aayog has recommended for the development of underwater archaeology. And this decade, from 2021 to 2030, UN is celebrating it as the decade of ocean science and for sustainable development. So this decade is really a time that we should also move towards the sea and the cultural heritage which is lying submerged or preserved for centuries, or even in certain cases maybe for the several millennia in the seas around our country, that we should focus on their search and study. And I am sure that if we do that, we will be able to understand our past better, and we would be able to reconstruct our history, about which we really do not know many of the things. Because our history has been focused more on the land, and we have not really exploited, or I won't say exploited, means you can say the used the remains which are lying submerged properly in the reconstruction of our history. So if you focus on that, that will be really very helpful for reconstructing the history of our country and the great things what we have done. We know in the past Indians have ventured in both way towards the east and the west, and they had large navies. They were having different long, large fleets of different kinds of ships. So in naval technology, we were not less than anybody else in the world. So we need to have more functional centers. We have to train those who are interested. We also need to have certain laws and share the information and resources. So Indian Ocean forms an important part of our cultural heritage. We need to look towards the sea, work more on that, have our strategies for that, and to raise more awareness of the cultural heritage and the significance of the ocean. So with this, I will stop here, and if anybody is having any comment or question on that, I'll be happy to note them.
Thank you very much, sir, for showing us a new field of science which I never thought of. This is really very interesting field of underwater archaeological activities. So few questions we have got. The first question is, what is the career for students in underwater archaeology? Do we recruit some person in this field, or the archaeologic persons are trained? How the scientists are trained by your organizations?
Yeah, As of now, we do not have any separate organization like in many other countries. There are career options in Archaeological Survey of India, means archaeology departments, be it a central or the state. All coastal states have got a scope for underwater archaeologists. Besides that, there are scientific institutions like the National Institute of Oceanography, National Institute of Ocean Technology, Department of Ocean Development. So there are a number of institutions where one can have the career prospects. But as specifically for underwater archaeologists, we do not have any institution as of now. But there are a lot of scope for work, and definitely in future, I am sure that we will have a better career prospects also.
Very good. Thank you, sir. The other question is, does sea around Lakshadweep has some reserve of uranium? Means, do you do some this type of activity also to find out uranium around in coastal areas, or it's a separate department?
Actually, we have never worked on that. It's not our domain. We focus only on the cultural heritage. I am sure that geologists and other departments might have been working on that, and they might be having information.
So, does Archaeological Survey have a separate department for biodiversity, means dinosaurs and other excavation work to find out all these things? Is there any separate department under your Archaeological Survey, or this is done by other bodies?
No, Archaeological Survey of India, you are talking about underwater archaeology?
Not only underwater, means anywhere else also. For example, people say to find out dinosaurs or other prehistoric animals. Which other department of the government does this job?
Okay. That is generally what you see in the films, that archaeologists are doing everything. But generally, archaeologists confine their job only with the humans, the dinosaurs and ugly animals and all, the paleontologists study them. And as far as underwater is concerned, we have got underwater archaeology wing, which is their dedicated job is to search for archaeological remains under the water.
Okay. Sir, one more question is, does underwater archaeology was helpful in establishing Ram Setu? In fact, we had one exhibition, Earth from Space, here in our center. So from that, we have actually there we have shown satellite pictures. So there was some landmarks which indicate that there was Ram Setu between Sri Lanka and India, between Rameshwaram and that. So did you did underwater archaeology help in finding out all these things, Ram Setu?
Let me tell you, so far there has been no systematic archaeological study in Ram Setu area. Of course, there are references in literature, in inscriptions, and this tradition is very old. So we have information, we have references of Ram Setu, and a large number of people believe in it. But as far as archaeology is concerned, so far no archaeological studies, means underwater archaeological studies, have been carried out.
I would request those who are present online to ask question to Dr. Alok Tripathi ji. I think you might be curious to ask your own questions. So please, you are all welcome. I think no more questions. So I would hand over to Shri Kailash Chandra ji for vote of thanks.
Okay. There is a question, sir. Why there is not much awareness about underwater archaeology compared to field? One student, Chandrika Sunkur, is asking this question.
That's a difficult question. Means why there is no awareness, it's very difficult to say. But yes, we all know that there is no awareness. It is not only the underwater cultural heritage. Of course, it's a very new subject. But even our cultural heritage itself, there is very poor information or awareness. And you means I sometimes feel that maybe because of the historical reasons, because even today we have got a sort of mindset where we feel, you know, that everything that government has to take care of it, whether it's a road, whether it is a system around you in your colony. Generally, we means as a democracy, every citizen has to get involved in everything. But generally, we have got that thinking that Sarkar karegi ya archaeology department karega. So that is one of what I feel sometimes. That's why people are not, and we really have this kind of volunteers coming and working on archaeological projects. Generally, if you go to Europe and America, you will find there are only a few professional. Rest all are the volunteers. But here, if you see the archaeological projects, you will find all that government-funded work. You hardly find any volunteers. I think now the awareness is coming, and particularly the young generation, they are well aware about the importance and they want to take part. And new programs are coming where people can take part, and slowly I believe that this awareness will also come.
Yes, sir. Just to add to this, your statements, I mean, I personally feel that in the past 15 to 20 years, people are now visiting a lot of historical monuments and sites also. Maybe in near Banaras, maybe in Delhi, so many places. And Archaeological Survey of India has already got excavation as various sites, and we as the National Science Center, in fact, we have organized lectures from Dr. Vasant Sindeji on archaeology, and Dr. Sanjay Munjal who spoke about Sinoli excavations. And this is another in the same series we have talked about the underwater archaeology. People are interested in the subject. They are getting into, and they in fact send us the suggestions, why not to organize lectures or discussions or the seminar or workshop on these subjects. Now, with these questions and all these, all you have answered, sir, I really thank you for spending your valuable time to us. And yes, you have given a very insight of the subject, and we do look forward to have such discussions and lectures in future also. With you, I also thank Dr. Sri Ramdas Ayyaji, who is the director in charge, for making us arrangements, for allowing us to do this program. And my colleagues, Sri Srivastava, Sri Dhamiji, and Sri Rakesh, and Kiniki, for contributing their efforts in organizing this program, right from the publicity till exhibitions. So, with these words, sir, I take permission from you to close the program, and see you very soon, sir. Thank you very much.